对阮这三个月，咱的题目是建立上帝教会。
These 3 months, we've been talking about building God's church.
咱开始讲到建立上帝教会这个宝贝。
We started by studying the building of the church treasure.
今天第三 message 讲到圣灵。
And this is the third message in this series, that is the Holy Spirit.
主耶稣讲，我要建立我的教会。
The Lord Jesus said, I'm going to build my church.
教会是耶稣的教会，不是咱的教会。
And this church belongs to Christ, and it does not belong to us.
是伊要建立，不是咱要建立。
He is going to build it, it's not us.
所以将三宝贝赐予教会。
And that's why he gave us these 3 treasures.
头一个是上帝道。
The first of which is the word of God.
教会无离开上帝道。
The church cannot be far away from the word of God.
你若无好读上帝话。
And so if you do not study the word of God carefully,
你的生命永远未成熟，未长进。
Then your life will never mature, and you will never grow as well.
你永远一个真正 shallow 的 Christian.
And you will always be a very shallow Christian.
你若灵性真成熟。
And but if you are spiritually mature, it is only then likewise that you can build the church of God. Second is the love of God. This does not refer to human love, but rather this is the love that comes from heaven. And that's why the Bible says we love because God first loves us. And the love of the Lord is unconditional. And using this kind of love, learning this kind of love, that we love each other. And the Lord Jesus said, if you love one another, then people will be able to tell that you are my disciples. Today we're going to talk about the third gift. That is the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. Let us look at John chapter 15, verse 26. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of Truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. The Holy Spirit comes so that he may testify about the Lord Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 1 verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The Holy Spirit is the one who gave us the power to become witnesses for the Lord. Just like people, like us who are very weak, it is not possible for us to do witnessing for the Lord. Because in our spiritual walk with God, we go up and down. Likewise, our emotions go up and down. And so people like us, how would it be possible for us to be witnesses for the Lord? And God knows that. The Lord Jesus knows that. And that's why he gave us the Holy Spirit. So that the Holy Spirit may help us to become the witnesses for the Lord. The Holy Spirit is actually a big topic. But today I will only focus on how the Holy Spirit will be helping the church in edifying and building up the church. We will be looking at 3 very important things. Firstly, is the Holy Spirit is our co-worker. The Holy Spirit is called as the Advocate.
Comforter,
he's also likewise a Comforter. John 14, verse 16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another Advocate to help you and be with you forever. That is another. So the Holy Spirit is the other Advocate. And so what does the Advocate mean? So an advocate is someone who comes beside you to comfort and help you. And so the Holy Spirit is the second advocate. And so then, who is the first one? And so the first one is the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is the first advocate. The Lord Jesus spent more than 3 years with the disciples. And he was there to protect the disciples. He also comforted the disciples. And also taught them. Now at this point, Jesus has left.
And
then he sent another advocate
代替耶稣,
who takes the place of the Lord Jesus
来安慰,来保护,来教导门徒的需要,
that he may also comfort and also help and also teach the disciples.
咱需要人在彼头帮助咱,
we always need people to be beside us, to help us.
没这个人有当家己,往这个世界里面,
there's no one who can ever exist alone in this world.
你需要别人,
you need other people,
别人需要你,
and likewise other people do need you as
well. Helping each other.
And so that we may help each other.
我这个老牧师的新加坡毕业的时候,
there's this elderly senior pastor when during the graduation, and so he told the seminarians, so today you are graduating, I give you this advice, and the best is for you to find a church and be working under a very experienced pastor and also learn things in humility and submit to the teachings, and then after a span of 3 or 4 years, if you are given the opportunity and you can start pastoring a smaller church, it's there that you develop and also exhibit your gifts and talents. And the reason behind this is quite simple, because every person that graduates from the seminary all feels that they are quite outstanding.
I am somebody.
They are somebody.
我毕业了,
that I have graduated.
我读了四年了,
I already spent 4 years of studies.
我,
I have a lot of things in my brain already.
去教会的时候,
and so as I enter the church,
我看到教会真罪没好色,
I also see a lot of problems and weaknesses inside the church.
改变教会,
so I have to do a complete reformation of the church.
结果呢,
and so consequently,
你得伤,
you got hurt.
教会得伤,
the church also got hurt.
结果你,
and so you left.
Bye bye, sayonara.
And you said bye bye and sayonara to the church. So you have to learn in humility, learn to be humble. So I have, since the time of my graduation until now, it's already 30 years.
100% agree.
And I 100% agree to this.
Yeah,
because this is my own experience as well. So after I graduated from the seminary, at that point I left Hong Kong and came to the Philippines. So for 2 years I was under a certain pastor.
Pastor Albert Nam.
That is a Pastor Albert
Lam.
He's a very experienced pastor and likewise a very excellent one. So under him I learned how to be a pastor and a minister of God. You know, I am a very submissive person. So I've never said no to him. And so whatever he instructs me to do, that I say yes. And so imagine one time, the worship service was at 9:30. So at 9 o'clock, he asked me to see him in his home. He says, I don't feel okay today, that I am not able to preach today. So you go and preach the sermon.
Imagine just 30 minutes.
So imagine, I only have 30 minutes.
Yes.
And so my answer to him was yes.
Yes. Okay.
So I did not say any other word but say yes to him. And so I used Genesis chapter 1 to preach a message.
I think it's good.
And I think it was good.
Yeah,
because of the response of the people was good as well. And also there were some people who gave feedback to Reverend Lam that I spoke quite well that day. You know what I want to say? That each one of us needs to be helped by someone. Of course, when we face difficulties, who's the one who is shielding us and helping us through these hardships? I know that for each of the pastors and also ministers, not all of them, but everyone will certainly face difficulties. Your families will have problems. Your companies also will have issues.
请问,
and so let me ask you, who's going to help you? Who can be there for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to stand and shield you from all of this? There will come to a day the person who's helping you will not be by your side. And so 2 years ago, our brother Pedro Tan, he's one of the people who have supported me 100% in the church. So for the span of
some decades,
this person, our brother, have never said any negative things about me, whether in front of people or behind my back. But then 2 years ago, he passed on. And so let me ask you, who's going to be standing beside me to help me? It is only the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our co-worker. He's helping us. He's helping the church. You know, I often tell my wife, it's not us who are leading the church, but rather it's God Himself who is leading His church. It's the Holy Spirit who is leading the church. I am not a foolish guy. And all of you are very intelligent. So if I am a very foolish person, how could I ever lead people who are intelligent just like you? I also can tell the problems of each of my co-workers. And also can tell the weakness of the life of each co-worker that I've worked with. It's not that I am not aware of that, but rather I am not expressing it. I also am not fixing it. It doesn't mean though that I am not aware of it, but rather I am giving you the chance. I'm giving you the opportunity to repent. Because if the Holy Spirit is not working, then God will continue to give us this opportunity. But in my 30 years of experience, I came to know when time comes, God naturally will come to work. Because the Holy Spirit is the one who is in control of the entire church. So when Jesus Christ left the world, and that is before the church was going to have the rapture. And so during this span of period, it is the generation or the time of the Holy Spirit. It is a time when the Holy Spirit is the one in control of the church. And so please remember, it is not us who is in control of the church, but rather it is the Holy Spirit who is residing among us and who is the Lord. And so when time comes, God naturally will be working. And so we have to wait upon the timing of the Lord. Quite a number of years ago, in mainland China, there was something that happened in a particular church.
This is a true story, okay?
This is actually a true story. And so there was this elder in that church. It's actually well known to be a very notorious elder. And so everybody was afraid of him. He seems to be acting just like a king in the church. And so if something is being done without letting him know ahead of time, and so you will be in trouble. And so even the senior pastor was very afraid of him. And then there was one time. And so the senior pastor happened to have done something without prior notice to this elder. And so news came. And so the next time we're going to have this meeting among the deacons and elders, I'm going to fix this pastor. And so hearing this news, the pastor became very afraid. And so on a Friday, nobody was in the church. He was all alone inside the church and praying to God. He doesn't know what to pray about. He only said one statement. Lord, I'm dead. Lord, I'm dead. I'm dead. And so suddenly as he was praying, and so when a certain leader of the church happened to pass by and saw him kneeling down and praying, crying out to God, I'm dead. Or that somebody's going to be dead. Oh, so because that night, that elder actually had a heart attack and died.
所以整教会都惊着。
And so the entire church was shocked.
忽然间死去。
Because that elder suddenly died.
忽然间有人说,
and then suddenly somebody said, that is that person, that leader who passed by the church. And he said, I know why he died.
牧师基督说, 死了, 死了。
Because I heard the pastor praying, dead, dead. He's the one who prayed for the elder to die.
你说对大以后,
and so from that time onwards, so all the elders became very, very behaved and became very submissive to the pastor. So maybe I should come to the church tomorrow and also pray.
上帝啦,最近,
if God works,
你不明白了啦,
then that's something you will not be able to comprehend.
有人说这句话真好啦,
somebody did said this.
你说书多行端哦,
you know, the book of Acts.
应该说明叫, the Acts of the Holy Spirit.
Should be renamed as the Acts of the Holy Spirit.
因为书多行端在里面,
because in the book of Acts,
圣灵这个字,
the word Holy Spirit had appeared more than 60 times.
教会实在是圣灵掌管的教会,
and indeed, the church is one that is controlled by the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is our co-worker. He's also our Lord.
And
the Lord God.
Secondly,
the Holy Spirit leads us into all truth. John chapter 16, verse 13. But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on His own. He will speak only what He hears, and He will tell you what is yet to come. So the Holy Spirit is the one who guides us into all the truths. He himself will not be speaking, but rather he will make use of the word of God to speak to us. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 20, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. That is, the church is founded in the apostles and prophets' teachings. What does that mean? That is in chapter 3, verse 5, which was not made known to people in other generations as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. So God gave his revelation to the apostles and prophets for them to know. And then these apostles and prophets also wrote down these revelations and became inspiration.
Timothy 2 Timothy
chapter 3 verse 16. All scripture is God breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And so that inspired the word of God was put down in writing and became the Bible. So let me repeat that. And so God revealed and told these apostles and also the prophets his heart, his will. And so after these apostles have written down,
inspiration.
And that became inspiration.
And so
when all these inspired writings were combined and put together, that became the Bible. And so when we say the church is founded in the apostles and the prophets, that means the church is founded in the truth. And the Holy Spirit also is named as the Spirit of Truth. We actually cannot understand the words in the Bible apart from the moving of the Holy Spirit. Because this book is no ordinary book.
Holy Bible.
This is the Holy Bible. That is, the Holy Spirit of God is there. And it needs the Holy Spirit to move us, to touch us, that we may understand the Word of God. And the Christians in this generation, we have this problem. That is, we lack 7 inches. What does it mean when we say the person lacks 7 inches?
From the head to the heart, 7 inches.
Because the distance between the head and the heart is 7 inches. And so we listen to the word of God. We also study and read the word of God. However, we leave them all here in the head
knowledge.
That is the head knowledge. But then we do not put the truth of God, the word of God, in our hearts. And so if the word of God is not in our heart, then there will not be any transformation in your life. The Pharisees, they are people filled with head knowledge. They are very familiar with the Bible. However, it all ended there.
It came 7 inches.
And so they lack this 7 inches. So how do we do that? We need the help of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit who helps us.
Head knowledge become your heart.
So that you convert the head knowledge into heart. So last time I told you about 2 Greek words.
Logos and rhema.
That is logos and rhema.
Logos and rhema 都是讲到上帝的道.
So both logos and rhema refer to the word of God.
但是没上帝的道.
However, where does the difference lie?
这本圣经,
this Bible,
全本圣经的, logos.
The whole Bible is logos.
约翰福音第一章第一节,
in Job chapter 1 verse 1 says,
太初有道，道及上帝同在, 这个道就是 logos.
In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and that word there is logos.
但是,
however,
logos 是客,
logos is actually an objective truth. However, we have to convert this objective truth into a subjective experience.
Experience. Rhema 什么意思?
And so what does rhema mean?
Rhema 是一节的圣经，而且一段的圣经， 这段圣经
that is a rhema, is a verse or portion of the scripture that the Holy Spirit brings to our attention with application to a current situation or need for direction. If you are reading the word of God and it always remains to be a logos and logos only,
teacher of the word.
So the most that you can become is to be a teacher of the word. But then there will be no change in your life. But then you have to convert this objective knowledge or truth that you have and make it an experience. In our church, there's this particular brother. So every time after I finish my sermon, whenever I get to meet him, he will tell me, new pastor, you know, the word of God today have spoken to me. And this is the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not my work. My work is to preach the word of God. And so it's the Holy Spirit who put His word into your heart and turns that into rhema.
So
and so you have to pray for this. That you come with a prepared soft
humble
heart.
Humble enough.
And humble enough.
You listen to the word of God.
To listen to the word of God.
Many
people ask me this question. Especially when these people know that I came from Hong Kong. And they ask, how come, Pastor, that you came from Hong Kong? Actually, it is something that is difficult to tackle or understand. So no matter how much I try to explain that, I find it difficult to give a very clear explanation. And so I could only say that this is how God has moved me. In reality, when after I graduated from the seminary, I started praying whether I should come to the Philippines to be a minister or not. However, at this point in time, I have 2 problems or issues. The first is, I feel that I am too young. So imagine this. So you deduct 30 years from what I am right now. So you see how young I was.
Means baby face.
And my face was baby face.
Baby face.
Indeed, I have this baby face.
Look.
And of course, not to mention that I'm handsome. And so if you don't believe that, you better ask my wife. You know, I was quite young. And so that was my first issue. And my second problem was, I don't know how to talk. I am not a Fukienese. I'm a Cantonese. So I cannot totally understand Fukien language. And so I do not have any relative at all in the Philippines. And so how could I ever come to the Philippines? So these are the two main struggles in my mind. Until one day, so as I was praying and seeking the will of God, and then suddenly, God used these two verses to speak to me. But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am too young.' You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you," declares the Lord. And then suddenly, these two verses become a very close reality to my life. Of course, this is not my first time to read this same passage. I have read this so many times already. But that, on that particular instant that I was reading it, and but then that particular verse becomes so real in my life at that time. This, at this point, this is no longer Logos, but instead has become Rhema. And to it was it caused me to have great faith. And so do not think that you are too young. And second thing is you need not be afraid. Because I'm going to give you the words. And so using and claiming these two verses, I came to the Philippines. And that's why I changed my name to Jeremiah. And now you understand why my name became Jeremiah. Because I want to remind myself, it's not that me who wanted to come to the Philippines, but rather it was God who moved me to come to the Philippines. And so, God, you have to take up that responsibility. It has passed 30 years. And the word of God is indeed so true. May the Lord God help us. The Holy Spirit is not merely our co-worker. The Holy Spirit is the one who leads us into all truth. And so you want to have changes in your life. In your life, these logos have to become a rhema. And so your response ought to be to obey, and that is obedience.
Number three,
the third work of the Holy Spirit is to fill the church. This is actually a very big, huge topic as well. But today I'm only going to talk about one thing. So how the Holy Spirit, as He fills the church, will build the church. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, "Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit." It was a very clear translation using the English version.
Be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so being filled by the Holy Spirit is never an active activity. It never happened, as recorded in the Bible, that a person is filled with the Holy Spirit because this person sought after the filling of the Holy Spirit. And in this generation of ours, it's actually quite chaotic. And people want to seek the filling of the Holy Spirit. They also want to speak in tongues.
Okay, so holy laughter.
Or they want to experience this holy laughter.
Holy cry.
Or even holy crying that can't stop crying. Or that they will be rolling all over. Because they want to pursue the filling of the Holy Spirit.
But then I tell you.
But the Bible never records that people have to seek or pursue the filling of the Holy Spirit.
Be filled with.
The Bible only says that be filled with. That is, on a passive note, we are being filled by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit already dwells in us. If the Holy Spirit does not dwell in us, then you are not yet saved. The Holy Spirit only resides in us. You don't even have to ask Him, but He's already there. There is only one thing that is missing. He is not able to fail you.
You know why?
You know why?
聖靈 是 Holy Spirit.
Because the Spirit of God is the Holy Spirit.
你的心内若无圣洁,
and so if in your hearts you are not holy,
你的心内若肮脏,
if there is dirt in your heart,
聖靈是无法充满你,
then the Holy Spirit cannot fail you.
你就逼迫你自己,
and so you have to prepare yourself.
你有这看不上帝的心,
you have to have a heart that desires God.
有这个心,
that you have a holy heart, it is then that the Holy Spirit will fill you. It is actually quite simple. Just like what? For example, you are chasing or pursuing a certain person. That is before you get married. Let's say brothers. You should have to take that active stand. So sisters, you don't have to be aggressive too. But you have to wait so that this man will come.
For example,
and one thing that I often tell you or teach you, that we have to greet each other. And so you introduce yourself.
I am Jeremiah.
You are.
Welcome to CBC.
And so welcome
for
to CBC.
For example, here the brothers.
So brothers, if you are still single and you're still available, so you notice this certain sister and you also realize that the sister is not yet married and still available, does not have any boyfriend, and you have the interest to be his friend, her friend. And so it's very simple. So during the greeting time, so you come and approach her. Hi, I am Jeremiah. And you are? Oh, I'm Boshan. Okay, that's the end.
Stop.
So don't be too aggressive.
Welcome to CBC.
But
next Sunday. Hi, Boshan, Jeremiah.
So you approach her again and say, hey, I'm this, and then stop again. So after a few times, so you're getting more acquainted, and so you can add another statement.
Oshan,
can I invite you for coffee?
Okay, why?
Is this okay?
UCC, no UCC, no problem.
Is this okay, UCC? Then they said, fine, okay. Let's go to UCC. Sisters, if you feel that you want to give this brother a certain chance and look at this brother, okay, not bad.
Why not?
Or let's say you are not interested at all.
You have the right to say no.
You have the right to say no as well. It says no.
I don't want coffee, I want tea. Okay, bye-bye.
I don't want coffee, I want tea, so bye. And so look at this situation. The Holy Spirit comes on His own initiative. And we need to respond. And so feeling of the Holy Spirit is not something that you can force upon.
But you need to be ready.
But then you have to be ready. It's just like that you are a container. And so if a person is holy, and this person is going to be used by God, but if you are not holy, then how can God ever use you? And so when a person is being filled by the Holy Spirit, what does that prove? That is, you are in control or controlled by the Holy Spirit. And you also likewise to have the power to become His witness.
Reverend Timothy Nim, 这个神学业,
and this is a president of a certain seminary, Reverend Timothy Lin. That to be spirit-filled is to be governed by the Holy Spirit, to continue to receive and enjoy God's power and authority, that we may be empowered for this present life and ministry. So this is a very good definition of what it means to be filled by the Holy Spirit. That is, you are governed by the Holy Spirit. And likewise, continuously receiving power from God that you may become witnesses for Him. Of course, I know you already came to know that a very prominent pastor, Reverend Billy Graham, passed away last Wednesday. This person who have served God for 60 years. Never had any bad news about his that affects his reputation. For the span of 60 years, he was very clean as far as money is concerned, as far as women is concerned. And he also explained what filling of the Holy Spirit means. Being filled with the Holy Spirit is not a question of how much you and I have of the Holy Spirit, but how much he has of us. The more the Holy Spirit is in control and in possession of us, the more we are filled with the Holy Spirit, and therefore, the more powerful we can serve, the more effective we can live holy lives. Being filled by the Holy Spirit is not to have more of the Holy Spirit, but rather how much the Holy Spirit has of us. And I feel this is a very good definition. So when the Holy Spirit have you, then your life will be changed. And so if the Holy Spirit has your mouth, then your words will not be just very casually spoken. You will also not say negative things about other people. You will not also be engaged in gossiping. When the Holy Spirit has your eyes, then your eyes will not be looking at things that you should not be looking at. When you are browsing the internet, you have to preserve the cleanliness of your eyes. And so when you come into some pornography, you know this is something the Holy Spirit is displeased with, because the Holy Spirit already has your eyes. So when the Holy Spirit has your ears, and so you don't want to hear all these gossips around, but then if the Holy Spirit does not have your ears yet, and so when some people are gossiping about other people, and he says, oh, what is that? And because you're just worried that you don't hear this, the gossip clear enough. So when the Holy Spirit has your hands, and the things that you do are completely different, and when your Holy Spirit has your feet, and so the places that you go to will also be different. So please remember, it's not that you having some more of the Holy Spirit, but then how much the Holy Spirit has of you. So which area of your life is already being governed or controlled by the Holy Spirit? So how many parts or aspects of your life is being surrendered to the Holy Spirit for you to have the full control? If a person is filled by the Holy Spirit, there are three manifestations.
Number one,
firstly,
that
your life will be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so when your life is being filled by the Holy Spirit, then you will bear the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So what is the fruit of the Holy Spirit? Galatians chapter 5 verses 22 to 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And so looking at the English Bible, the fruit is put in a singular form, and that means there is only one fruit. However, that one fruit has nine manifestations, and I find this to be very beautiful. If you have the fruit of the Holy Spirit, then your life will manifest all of these nine different aspects. You know, at times, that's how we put it. But I am not gentle. I am not patient. That is what I am. But then I have all the others. Oh, I have love. I also have joy. But yes, I don't have that forbearance.
No. I'm sorry to tell you.
No excuse. There is no excuse to that. When the Holy Spirit dwells in you, so that means you have all of this, it's a matter of death only. That is how much you have of it. And so your life will have some fragrant aroma. Last year, the whole family went to Taiwan. There was one particular evening, we went to a night market, and so as we were walking, and so suddenly my two daughters were talking. It says it's a foul smelling. It smells so bad. And so we were looking around. At a far distance, there's a table selling stinky tofu. The stinky tofu of Taiwan is really very stinky. So the smell is really so horrible. So at a far distance, you are able to smell that. So let me tell you. So when your life is being governed by the Holy Spirit, then there will be a fragrant aroma in your life. That is the fragrance of Christ is in your life.
Number two, 你的工作和圣灵充满,
that is secondly, the ministry that you do is filled with the Holy Spirit.
你的工作就有,有,有 effective, 有功效,
and with that, your ministry will become effective.
因为你的事,有圣灵来引出你,
because as you serve, there is the Holy Spirit who is leading you.
圣灵很好, example 是 Philip.
A very good example in the Bible is Philip.
Philip. 坐这个太监，这个埃埃底阿帮个太监先做的歌手。
And so Philip was the one who led this Ethiopian eunuch to come to know the Lord.
那时候，Philip在撒加撒玛利亚所在最近。
At that time, Philip was in Samaria and he was working there.
真有成就。
He was very successful.
真有果效。
It was very effective and productive.
但忽然间,
but then suddenly,
上帝就这个启示给你讲喂。
God sent an angel and spoke to Philip. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.
Go to the south, go to the south.
And then suddenly the Holy Spirit, this angel of the Lord spoke to Philip and said, go to the south. But then that south is actually a desert road. So it's a place without people. And so what is he going to do there?
Philip,
if you were Philip, what will you say? There's no one there. So what are you going to send me for? I have to do many other things here. No. Philip did not say any word.
Obey, obedient.
But then he was obedient.
He just killed.
And so there he went. And so he walked. And suddenly the spirit, he saw this chariot. This chariot that was standing there. And the Holy Spirit told Philip, go to that chariot.
Philip is a man.
Philip is a person, is a man. He's not a horse. But the man has to chase this horse. And so he had to run. And then there he saw a man reading the scriptures. He was reading the book of Isaiah. And Philip asked him, Do you understand what is being read there? He says, how could I understand when no one teaches me? And so let me tell you. And so Philip, as he was in the chariot, shared the gospel to this person. And because of that gospel, was preached and reached Africa. You know, church, did you see that? If your ministry is submissive to the feeling or the touching of the Holy Spirit, you know, the effects or the results after that is something that you will not be able to imagine. Because of one man, gospel has reached Africa.
Number three,
when you are filled by the Holy Spirit, your emotions are also being filled by the Holy Spirit. You know, we the Chinese have this saying that each person has seven emotions. What are these? Joy, anger, sadness, fear, love, evil, desire. So all these seven emotions are actually neutral in nature. So there's nothing right or wrong about it. So it depends on how you utilize these emotions. But then, when you are filled by the Holy Spirit, these are seven emotions have to be sanctified. What does sanctification mean? It's very simple. For example, this anger, and this is love. How do I sanctify anger or love?
Sanctify your emotions.
That is to love what God loves and to be angry at what God is angry about. That is sanctifying your emotions of love and anger. So Christians, are we allowed to get angry?
No, of course not.
Of course not.
We are Christians.
We are Christians.
We love people.
We love people. So you should not get angry.
No, you are wrong.
No, you're wrong. You should get angry. But you should be angry at the things that God is angry at. And also love what God loves. God has this name that I am a jealous God.
Huh?
He says, huh? God, a jealous God?
How
could he be a jealous God? And this is no ordinary jealousy. It is holy jealousy. So let me explain it this way for you to understand. What is jealousy and what is admiration? You know what does this mean? For example, say one day, I saw this woman.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah,帥哦.
Very beautiful. Oh, even more beautiful than my wife. Not only that.
真溫柔,
very gentle.
真順服,
also very submissive.
竟然比我太太那个温柔顺服,
even more gentle and submissive than my wife.
感谢主,没看到,
thanks be
okay?
to God.
你不能倒过啊,没看到,
you haven't seen it, so don't look.
我说, for example, okay,
I said, for example,
我看到这个路耶,
I saw this woman.
比我太太那个水,
more beautiful than my wife,
submissive,
more submissive,
那个温柔,
and also more gentle.
我是弯刀还是欣赏?
So am I jealous or am I admiring this person?
Admire. Okay? But 让我太太,
but if my wife was taken by another man, so what happens there? Is that a jealousy or an admiration?
Jealousy. Okay?
Jealousy.
What's the difference?
What's the difference?
是你的物件,
something that belongs to you was taken by others.
Yeah, 弯刀.
So you will become jealous.
那不是你的物件,
but if something that does not belong to you and was taken by others,
你是admire.
You only admire.
第二个, 咱是属上帝的,
we belong to God.
上帝created人,
God created us.
天人,
God loves us. And he was crucified on the cross for us.
那有别的神,
and so if there are other gods that take us away from him,
上帝弯刀,
then God will become jealous.
因为咱不是上帝的物件,
because we initially already belong to him.
这个就 sanctify your emotion, your jealousy, your hatred and your love.
That is sanctification of your emotions, of your hatred, your love, or jealousy. So church, each one of us has emotion. But then if your emotions are not filled by the Holy Spirit, and then these emotions will come so scary. May the Lord God help us. The Holy Spirit is the one helping the church. He is our co-worker. He helps us to enter into all the
truths.
He helps us and he fills us so that our life, our ministry, and also our emotions will become clean and sanctified. So that we may build the church of God. May the Lord God help us. Starting from next week,
这个健康的教会，这个真正特别的特点在哪？
The characteristics of a healthy church.
求主帮助我们。
May the Lord God help us. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending this other advocate who is there to be with us, to comfort us, to lead us into all truth, to teach us, and to be our co-worker. Father, we thank you because we know and we realize it's not us who is at work. It's not us who has to labor. It's not us who has to get all this glory, but it is all yours. You are the one who is at work. You are the one who brings fruits. You are the one who brings about transformation. You are the one who needs to be glorified. And thus we pray, Lord, that each one of us and as a church corporately, Lord, that we will seek the filling of the Holy Spirit in the way that we cooperate with you. We allow you to work in us so that your name may be lifted up. Father, we pray that you continue to work in our hearts, Lord, that truly your aroma will be manifested in our lives and people will smell this aroma and attract them into your kingdom. Father, we thank you because all of this are merely your works and not something that we can do on our own. And whatever that has come out of all of this, whatever fruits that we have gained, Lord, all this we submit to you, we lay down before your throne so that you will be glorified and your name will be magnified. Thank you so much for allowing us to be workers with you, because this is indeed a greatest privilege that we could ever have. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.